request Arvind Mishra sir to please ask our chief guest today, Shri Pankaj Mishra sir, to give the keynote address. Thank you, sir, and thank you, dear participants, once again. Thank you. Surendra, please, if you may take some time out. Thank you.
I would like to request my joint director, Shri Surendra Mohan sir, to kindly speak a few words at this juncture.
Hello. I hope I am audible.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much, ADG sir, learned ADG sir. And I have seen true leaders like you who always yield space for the subordinates. And that is the biggest virtue. And in front of learned ADG sir and Sri Pankaj Mishra sir, saying something is like telling everybody that sun is warm and water is wet. So I am much junior than these two distinguished officers of the department. But as joint director of DTRTI, because my learned ADG sir has directed me, so I have to say a few words. So friends, first of all, we live in the age of information society. And there are a lot of information roaming here and there around us. We are just piled up with the information. We are buried under the information. We have WhatsApp, social media, and all this. So there is no dearth of information at all. But the problem is that all informations are not intelligence. So for converting information into specific targetable intelligence, you need data mining. Also, data mining is such a particular aspect of technology that you are from the ocean of information, you need that specific targetable information which can work for you. So for that, there are a lot of technology like artificial intelligence, machine learning, data mining, but we are not that very good in those technologies. So when we discuss the course calendar of this year, we along with our team in the DTRTI discussed about this course, and we found that because my experience in the field suggested that we are not using the mechanism available to us to utmost level. After that, we discussed with our learner ADG sir, and our learner ADG sir was so humble that he agreed for this course. So let me first talk about REIC. So let me tell you that in the investigation directorate Kolkata, we worked there, and we used to have regular meetings of the REIC. So we always exchange the information whenever there is any foreign X or FEMA angle to any case. We inform to the REIC and in turn to inform in enforcement directorate. If there is any bank related issue where any SSE did some forgery with the bank or misused or used that loan for other purposes, we inform CBI. So, but when from the directorate, when I came to the assessment, I found that very few assessing officers are intimating to REIC such cases. They are doing wonderful job, but their work is buried in the file itself. They are not giving that data to the other agencies. And that is not only important, but it's also necessary, because in case of any such issue unearthed in the future, you would be in trouble. And there's a possibility that vigilance angle would also involve in this case. And let me tell you that I was, with regard to collection from one cell company, I was investigating the case. We found the traces to the Jammu Kashmir, related with the Jammu Kashmir bank. And we found that a lot of suspicious transactions. I informed my principal, CIT sir, there. He in turn intimated through higher authority. And what the message we got in return is that you given a good lead to NIC, National Investigation Agency. So you can understand that our little awareness about the intelligence can help other agency like leaps and bounds. So for example, and let me tell you, the FIU always gives us suspicious transaction report, STRs. And those are the wonderful information. So what we usually do, because In Kolkata directory, we are piled up with a lot of SDRs. There are 500 SDRs to dispose. So we used to dispose for the sake of disposing. But if you go downward, forward in the SDRs, you will find that you can find vendors. You can find vendors. You can develop a lot of case from there. So, friends, I would say that we are not using information as intelligence, and we need a lot of training in that. For that purpose, this course was conceived, and we also requested Sri Pankaj Mishra sir to address our audience, our participant, because he having a lot of experience. He's a stalwart in our department when intelligence comes in picture. So I'm not much to offer because in front of the Sri Pankaj Mishra sir and Sri Vivek Kumar sir, our AD sir. So I would request Sri Arvind Mishra sir, so please proceed further, and all the participants want to hear Sri Pankaj Mishra sir. So I would not take much time, and without any further ado, I would request Mishra sir to kindly proceed further.
It is my privilege to introduce Sri Pankaj Mishra sir for the benefit of all the participants of this webinar. Friends, Sri Pankaj Mishra sir is an officer of 1989 batch of the Indian Revenue Service. He is a postgraduate from University of Delhi. Mr. Mishra has extensive and varied experience. He has worked extensively in the field of formation of the Income Tax Department, handling audit of the corporate and non-corporate taxpayers. Mr. Mishra sir has a long experience in the area of financial investigations, tax evasion related investigations, and also in the area of policy formulation for financial investigations. Mr. Mishra sir has worked in the Ministry of Home Affairs on deputation basis for 5 years as Director of Internal Security, where he dealt with various subjects including policy formulation to combat terrorism, including combating financing of terrorism. He has played a pivotal role in the amendment of India's anti-terrorism law to respond to the needs to combat terrorism and financing of terrorism, and also to bring it in compliance with the FATF standards in 2008 and 2012. He was also involved in drafting of the National Investigation Agency Act, the NIA Act, and in the creation of NIA as India's leading investigative agency to investigate cases of terrorism and financing of terrorism. Mr. Mishra sir was also involved in the amendment of Prevention of Money Laundering Act in 2012. Mr. Mishra has been the key member of India's team that worked for India's membership of the FATF. He's been involved with FATF and related activities in India since 2006 and has represented India at FATF, APG, and at EAG. Mr. Mishra is the director of FIU India since June 2016, and he's additional secretary to the Government of India. Mr. Mishra sir is the leader of Indian delegation to FATF since 2017. He's also the leader of Indian delegation to APG, EAG, and Egmont Group. And for this particular course, we are very honored to have Mr. Mishra with us, and we are very excited to hear Mr. Mishra. Sir, it's all yours.
Good morning to everyone, and thank you for your kind words, my dear friend Arvind. Let me begin by thanking Principal DG NADT, Vivek Kumar ADG, Mr. Surendra Mohan, and my very old and dear friend Arvind Mishra, and all the colleagues at DTRTI Lucknow for having given me and my officers this opportunity. So I'll begin by giving you a brief background of what financial intelligence units are. As you would be knowing, the financial intelligence units are actually a creation of the recommendation of the Financial Action Task Force, which mandates that every country shall have a financial intelligence unit set up, and accordingly, to comply with these standards, the Government of India set up Financial Intelligence Unit India in April 2005 under the Prevention of Money Laundering Act. So the Financial Action Task Force is an international body which sets standards on anti-money laundering combating of financing of terrorism and proliferation financing. This is a very exclusive group which has a very, very restricted membership requirements. So India is amongst one of the 36 countries around the globe which is a member of Financial Action Task Force since 2010. Now coming to the topic, as Surendra rightly said, that there is information, then there is intelligence, and we need to sift through the information to make it into a workable intelligence, an actionable intelligence. When you talk of intelligence, we must always keep in mind the investigation, because no intelligence can be of use until some inquiry, some investigation has been done. It is only the investigation or the inquiry which confirms or denies the validity of the existing intelligence. And therefore, every intelligence agency, not only Financial Intelligence Unit India, but every intelligence agency seeks a validation of its intelligence inputs. A lot of intelligence work is done by the various law enforcement authorities who handle investigations. For instance, even our investigation wing handles a lot of intelligence, and a lot of intelligence is gathered by you yourself, from whether from open sources or through informants. In our times when we were there in the investigation wing, we did not have the benefits of so much of data and so much of intelligence. So it was more of open source, more of public, then drilling down through it. And basically, I would say, depending on human intelligence. The technology has brought to the fore the benefits of having data, its quick analysis and understanding. But along with technology having supporting the collection and analysis of intelligence, what we see is that technology has also aided and abetted a lot of economic crimes and economic offenses. The Income Tax Department as a whole and investigation wing of the Income Tax Department may not be dealing with economic offenses per se, but what all of us need to realize is that this department has the largest pool of trained financial investigators, people who can drill down and who can find out what actually is the transaction and how does it relate. In my experience of having worked in different ministries and departments of the Government of India, I can say with a lot of confidence that the talent that we have, that is the Income Tax Department, is rarely found in any other department. When it comes to financial investigation, it is the Income Tax Department which is actually the leader, which has the maximum number of knowledgeable people, the talent, the ability to understand and comprehend transactions very quickly, which a lot of other agencies find it very challenging. So we must take pride in our work, and we must take pride in our manpower, that over the years, this department has, as a collective body, formed a very, very specialized cadre which can investigate any kind of financial transactions and any kind of financial wrongdoing. It's a different matter that every financial economic offense or a financial wrongdoing is not actionable under the Income Tax Department. But as Surendra said, that the role there begins that we inform the concerned department, which is, I think, as per the mandate of the CBDT as well, that where some other department is involved, the Income Tax Department has to inform them. Now, as I said, that with the increasing economic offenses, there is a need to take a holistic approach. And this requires coordination between different agencies of the government, which is crucial for any effective results in terms of both prevention as well as investigations. We have large amount of data which is being collected and processed by all agencies today. But data analytics, which is being used extensively for decision making. What we need to remember is that data analytics is only a tool to aid decision making. Data analytics is not an end in itself. In fact, to make best use of advanced data analytics, it is important to understand the process of data collection and analysis itself so that the results of data analytics can be applied differently to different cases and at different points of time, instead of blindly following the leads that data analytics offers. I must say that data analytics is also a form of intelligence, and like all intelligence, it is only a building block in the entire unfolding story of the case at hand. The STR intelligence, which is shared by FIU, is similarly another intelligence input which is available to the investigators, apart from many other sources of intelligence that the investigator has access to or makes use of routinely. I have always maintained that even because the maximum number of STRs are sent to CBDT, the Income Tax Department, but I've always maintained that STR is one of the inputs that we give, because having worked in the department, I know that there are many other points from which intelligence is coming in, and it is for the department to process all of it, all the intelligence that he has, to further take decisions. And as Surendra was saying, that there is STR, and we in our department, because of the law, we have to take some decision. And that is actually, I should say, incoherent with the requirements of setting up of FIU. The FIU is mainly set up to give intelligence regarding money laundering, terrorist financing, proliferation financing, and predicate offenses. Now, predicate offenses are the offenses which are listed. Which are listed in the schedule to the Prevention of Money Laundering Act. What we need is that the STRs from FIU India, they need not be viewed in the perspective of a TEP. There is a difference between a tax evasion petition which comes in, and there is a and STR is different, because STR is giving pointed intelligence about the transaction, about the person, about his financial handlings, and maybe it is not necessary that it is used at that very point on which it is received. It can just remain as a building block, and somehow the department should have the prerogative of using the intelligence at the appropriate time. I would also like to mention that the STR may not be, as I said, relevant today, but seen together with another STR or any other intelligence input received at a later date would make it much more relevant. We also have a system that STR is something which we give, where we have another system by which we respond to the various requests that comes in from different law enforcement authorities. Now, apart from CBDT, FIU India interacts and gives information and intelligence to various other law enforcement and intelligence agencies, which includes the Central Bureau of Investigation, Enforcement Directorate, Director General of GST Intelligence, DRI, all the state police, to NIA, and various other intelligence agencies of Government of India. And we have a mechanism and a framework by which it is a two-way traffic. The second is that we keep getting requests for details from various law enforcement agencies. The requests for information which we receive from the law enforcement agencies are mainly to seek additional information that may be available with FIU in respect of a case that is currently under investigation, or even in cases where investigation enforcement actions are being contemplated. So while building up a case for investigation, we keep getting these requests, and in turn, the FIU, if it does not have the requisite information or intelligence in its database, has legal powers to approach the bank or any other financial institution to seek that information and give it to the concerned law enforcement agency. When FIU is seeking information from the various financial institutions, it does not name the LEA from which the request has come. So for the financial institution, the request is only from FIU India. It does not know who made the request and to whom it would be disseminated. The other important thing which is handled by FIU India is we interact with our international partners very closely. So as I said, that FATF has mandated every country to set up a financial intelligence unit. So there is a global body of FIUs, which is known as the Egmont Group. And this has more than 163 countries and their FIUs as members. So India is also a member of the Egmont Group. And a lot of intelligence exchange takes place with various FIUs. And this information exchange is basically, again, two-way function. One is that we make a request. So FIU India makes requests, Suomoto, that we do not have any requests from our LEAs, but we have found something and we want to further have the analysis and intelligence to develop it at our end. We make a request to the concerned FIU of another country. The other part is that there is an LEA. For instance, we get requests from CBDT, we get requests from ED, from CBI, and many other police organizations to get intelligence from a foreign FIU about the financial dealings of the person in that country. So we send it out to that country and we get a response to that. And the third is that the 163 member Egmont group, they also, if they find something which pertains to an Indian citizen or an Indian resident, which they find as something suspicious, they send it to us without our asking, which is known as spontaneous disclosure by that FIU. So this is a very strong mechanism. And I must tell you that on an average, we send out about 20-25 requests every day to different FIUs, foreign FIUs every day. And we get about, in a year, 95% to 98% of the response. Some of them is a spillover which comes over in the next year. So this has been a very, very effective mechanism. And combined with our domestic STR regime and with the Egmont exchange of intelligence with our counterpart FIUs, FIU's intelligence has been used in all major economic crime cases which have been investigated or are being investigated by various agencies. So every major investigation that has taken place has the footmark of FIU's intelligence somewhere or the other. In a number of cases, the FIU's intelligence has been used as a starting point by different agencies, including CBDT. I'm aware that based on our intelligence, there have been searches carried out, and I'm told that there have been very successful searches which have been carried out. Having said this, I would like to briefly touch upon, because we have our work is mainly IT based and we have an IT system which has lived its life. So we are in the process of upgrading it to which we call as the FinNet 2, and it is expected to be operational by early next year. FinNet 2 would bring about a major transformational change in terms of how data is processed, analyzed and disseminated to LEAs. It envisages extensive use of AI and ML in processing and analyzing reports that are collected by FIU India. One of the important features, because I understand that reading the STR itself at times becomes very tedious. So what we have envisaged in this FinNet 2 is that there would also be an online learning module, which we call as LMS. And that would be open to officers of all LEAs. So you can log in and you can go through the courses, you can read it, you can attempt the online examination, and based on certain criterias and percentage of marks given, you will be given a certificate. So this would be made open to officers of all law enforcement agencies, including CBDT, which is our partner for whom we give intelligence. It is also open for all financial intelligence, for all financial institutions, so that their officers can also learn and file more pointed and better quality reports. And it is also for the officers of FIU India to learn more about the entire mechanism of the functioning of FinNet 2, as well as what the international community and what are the international standards. So this is something which I feel would be of interest to a number of you once we commence the operation early next year. As I said, the basic mandate of FIUs is to collect, analyze, and disseminate intelligence that could potentially aid in preventing money laundering and terrorist financing. So although the priority area for FIU India remains intelligence on money laundering and terrorist financing, and very strictly speaking, as per the international standards, tax evasion, tax recovery are not the required priority areas. However, having seen India's framework of handling economic offenses and economic crimes, and as Surendra was saying, that how one case gets linked to a case of terror financing, which could be of interest to NIA. We have been disseminating a large number of STRs, which we are conscious of, to the Income Tax Department. And this is because we feel that at the stage when STR gets reported or analyzed, more often than not, it cannot be said conclusively that it is a clear case of money laundering or terrorist financing. There is, however, a financial transactions which are involved. And therefore, we have some kind of an expectation that with the large pool of highly skilled and trained manpower which the Income Tax Department has, and the strong systemic investigation framework that the department has, perhaps the Income Tax Department could be the first one to detect, apart from tax evasion, whether there is any angle of money laundering or terrorist financing, and it can inform the concerned agency. So that is one of the reasons why a large number of these STRs are going to Income Tax Department, because the department can handle it much quickly and can have a comprehensive understanding much faster than other departments. There would be, I'm told there would be two more sessions by two other officers. Shailesh would be speaking on at length on domestic coordination, because he handles that. So he would be handling a lot of your questions, and he would go a lot in depth with what FIU does and how the analysis is done, what kind of reports are sent out. And then Chaitanya Shukla is the second speaker, who would be speaking about the technological upgradation and how to see things. You can ask him questions, both of them, about how to understand an STR, because as I said, reading STRs at times is a very, very tedious process. And the way it has been constructed years back, there is some confusion. And it's not very easily comprehensible, especially to a person who is handling STRs initially. Our attempt in FinNet 2 has been to make this process much more easier. So we have been conceiving of what we call as the case summary. So the case summary would at the first instance give the concerned officer an overview of the case. That what is it, and how many watchlists this person is, what are the transactions, with whom he has transacted, who is linked, why is this person we are saying is linked, what is the risk rating which is being given to this person. So our effort has been to make it even much more easier for you to comprehend the intelligence which is going. And I hope that would add value to your work. So this is, I have given you a broad overview of what FIU India does. But there is no denying that in our experience, having worked with different intelligence agencies and investigative agencies, there is a lot of value addition which is done by other intelligence agencies based on our reports. Because we find that at a number of times after they have analyzed our reports, they give us another report which has further added value to what we had disseminated. And therefore, it is very much important that there is a very, very close interaction between different law enforcement agencies as well as the intelligence agencies, because different intelligence agencies have different capacities and expertise. And all of this comes into play. And this is very important, because if the desire is that the economic offenses have to be dealt with a firm hand, then this all of government approach is something which is beneficial. And for this, we require very close interactions. I would not step into the shoes of other law enforcement agencies and intelligence agencies, because it is for them to speak on that. But I can vouch that over the years, I have seen that a closer interaction is always much beneficial, because they have a lot of intelligence which I may not be having, or FIU does not have, and that adds a lot of value to what we are doing. And we have benefited a lot as an organization because we interact very closely with them. It's on a personal basis, it's over telephones, over mails. So the interaction which FIU has with a lot of these law enforcement and intelligence officers, my officers, it's more of a very, very open interaction that they have. And that's a very welcome change that has come about. And there are no hesitations, even in criticizing. And therefore, we always ask for a feedback on our intelligence, on our STRs, because feedback is important, one, at the level of the management, be it the additional commissioner or the joint commissioner. He can keep tab of how many STRs have come, what has happened, what has gone wrong. So that helps, one, in the MIS part. The other thing, it also helps us. It also helps us to know that, you know, this particular STR has not been of use. And this is the reason that, well, it was wrongly reported. The transactions are wrong. The data which was captured is wrong. Account number is wrong. So that helps us in pulling up the banks, pulling up the financial institutions, and insisting that there is more to be done as far as quality is concerned. And the focus of FIU India remains on the quality which is being filed. Unfortunately, we have a lot of quantity, which we also realize that the focus should be more on quality, and that is what we have been emphasizing. And if we have a feedback from the law enforcement agency officers, that would greatly aid us, because at the end of the day, as I said, it is you people who are on the ground who are going to validate the intelligence. Because until and unless it is validated, intelligence has no meaning. Intelligence is something which needs to be acted upon. And then when it is acted upon, we get to know whether it has been validated or not. So please feel free to even send us a negative feedback, because that helps us. Coming to the end, I would also take this opportunity to mention that FIU India is an organization which is staffed by different officers from different departments. So we have people from Indian Revenue Service, Income Tax, we have people from Customs. We have a senior IPS officer working here. We have people from Engineering Services. But at the Deputy Director level, we are keen to have more officers from our service, because given their expertise, it helps us. It helps in better generation of intelligence. And therefore, I would also take this opportunity to request those who are interested at the level of Deputy Director, which would basically mean officers, IRS officers of the batch of 2015 and above. So 15, 14, 13, 12. And it would be a good opportunity for them to be a part of many fast-paced changes that are currently happening in India and the world, because if working in FIU India, it gives you a lot of international exposure. It gives you a lot of exposure to international visits and also to analyzing and disseminating international intelligence. So I think that it's a good experience. We have quite a few direct recruit officers from the Indian Revenue Service who are working here as deputy directors. Also from Customs and Central Excise, we have a number of officers. We, as I said, we have, I think, three IRS officers, four IRS officers rather, who are working as additional directors, joint directors here. So we are looking for officers of the level of deputy director. So if anybody is interested, he is most welcome to apply. And I think we have overshot the time. So I would like to thank each one of you for your patience. And I would also like to thank once again, Mr. Vivek Kumar and his team at DTRTI, and wishing you all the best. And if any of you have any issues, even regarding STR or about this thing, you can always get in touch with Mr. Shailesh Thakur and his team. Shailesh heads the domestic coordination, so he coordinates with all the domestic agencies, and he's more than happy to address your issues, to clarify, and that would also be adding a lot of value. So with these words, thanks a lot to all of you. Take care and best wishes.
Thank you very much, sir, for the wonderful words. And of course, my ADG would like to add a few words here.
Thanks a lot, sir, giving us a great overview of the working of the Financial Intelligence Unit, sir, and its good work being disseminated to all the financial agencies. I was in the investigation wing in Delhi. At that time, we used to receive many STRs, and now it is really very heartening to know that FIU has become a friend to all agencies for procuring information and giving it to them. Because in those times, it was very difficult to do inquiry before doing any course action, because obviously things would be out of control, people would be knowing it. It is a very, very welcome change that we are working in coordination. And in future, I think if all the agencies even come closer together, that way the usability of the data, its applicability in all round activities would be very good, sir. I hope, I believe your lecture to and guidance to all of us, including the participants here, has been very fruitful, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, and all the best.
Sir, my joint director, sir, was very much riveted to you when you were speaking, and I've seen him absolutely, you know, totally almost drinking all the drink that you were offering right now. So, sir, I would like to request, sir, to kindly say a few words of thanks.
Sir, you want me, sir?
Yes, sir. Because I've been watching you, absolutely, you are totally riveted to what sir was saying. And in fact, sir was also mentioning you also again and again, because you have had such vast experience with investigation that we would really request you to offer the vote of thanks, sir.
On behalf of Team DTRTI, on behalf of our learned ADG, sir, on behalf of Sri Arvind Misra, sir, and all the members of the DTRTI, I am really overwhelmed that Sri Pankaj Misra, sir, set the tone for today. And working in financial intelligence unit is not a small thing, because when we were preparing for the civil services during around 2010, so at that time, just 2 years back, that unit came into existence. And we were so excited about hearing about that unit. And after that, in the department, I got the opportunity to deal with the STRs. So I found that what a great work this particular organization is doing. So, sir, I would say that you set the tone and for the course, and your insight about the FIU and STRs are would help all the officers of the department. And sir, out of your busy schedule, you taken out for us, time for us. So I'm really thankful for that to you. And I would request you, so please be in touch with DTRTI, and please also in future entertain our request. So as be a keynote speaker for our courses, because when you speaks with your specialization and all your insights, it really helps us. So with all this, a very big thank from bottom of my heart on behalf of Team DTRTI. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much once again, sir, on behalf of all of us, for having visited us here and for having delivered this keynote address.
Thank you.
For all of us. And for the participants, I would like to request them to please keep in mind sir's request that you must participate in the working of FIU, and all those who are at the level of deputy commissioners should consider joining FIU if you are having the passion and the zeal and the enthusiasm to work towards collection and dissemination of information. So friends, we move on from here to the first session of today, and that is going to be delivered by Ms. Himani Bhayana, and it is my privilege and honor to welcome Madam Himani Bhayana, who is a Indian Revenue Service officer of the Customs and the Indirect Taxes Services. So a few words about Madam Himani. She has done her mechanical and automation engineering and is a 2006 batch officer of the IRS CNIT service. She has handled service tax for the first 7 years of her career, both in the field and in the ministry as Undersecretary of Service Taxes. She was part of a study group which was formed in 2012 to frame a common tax code for central excise and service tax, which was to be a precursor to the GST. In 2016, she was part of the first team of officers in the GST Council Secretariat. Ms. Himani Bhayana has spent the next 3 years being a part of the GST policy wing of the Department of Revenue, which was responsible for rolling out the GST. In 2019, she joined the MDI, which is the Management Institute at Gurgaon, the famous Management Institute, for a BG diploma course in public policy and management. Madam Himani Bhayana is currently posted in the office of the Principal Chief Commissioner of Customs in Delhi Zone. She has been awarded the Finance Minister's Gold Medal for the best probationer and the Chairman's Gold Medal for the topping the departmental examinations as a probationer also. In 2017, she was awarded a certificate of appreciation by the board for rendering dedicated and meritorious services. So today, Madam Himani Bhayana will be talking about the work of REIC, which she has been coordinating with a great deal of zeal. In fact, when we tried to find out who is that officer whose contribution to REIC has been tremendous, if you look at the last many years, earlier years also, then unmistakably, I was referred to Madam Himani Bhayana. So therefore, once again, welcoming Madam Himani Bhayana to this All India webinar and the topic that she will be dealing with is holistic approach to combating economic offences. The description of the topic is that REIC is a forum which actually brings together various intelligence and enforcement agencies of the central and state governments in order to ensure holistic investigation of economic offences. So that is Madam Himani Bhayana's introduction for you all, and Madam is there with us, and once again welcoming her to the webinar. We would like to request Madam to begin her presentation at this point of time.
Thank you very much, Sri Vivek Kumar sir, ADG DT RTI in Lucknow, and his team of officers. So I must compliment you and your team in the beginning itself. I must say the way the webinar has been organized and the officers getting in touch with me way ahead in time, giving me almost 2 weeks time notice, and it is organized. It speaks highly of the team and your leadership. So kind words of introduction were, I think, a bit too much, but thank you. And I just want to give a disclaimer that since morning in our office, there's been some, major electricity issue in Delhi. So the light, keeps going on and off. The generator is on, and I have put my hotspot as the, internet connection, because I'm not relying on my Wi-Fi modem. So in case there is some disruption, so just bear with me and I'll try to, sort of switch over to another hotspot in case, there is some issue. So with those words, let me just start sharing my presentation.
Yes, ma'am, we can see your presentation.
Like it was mentioned, the topic is REIC, Holistic Approach to Combat Economic Offences. This is, in fact, the logo of REIC. I think it's got a beautiful slogan, Nava Rambahan Anya Rabha Sita Taam Vayati. Now, I hope I pronounce it correctly. It means every new beginning comes from some other beginning's end. So, specifies the role of REIC. So the background of REIC, for that, to know that, we have to just step back and know what is CEIB. So idea of the Central Economic Intelligence Bureau was born when an empowered group of ministers found that law enforcement agencies, LEAs is what we call them, they were having voluminous data of economic offenses covering different sectors of the economy, but there was no monitoring of the gaps and weaknesses in the systems. So in light of the linkages between economic offences and national security, the Economic Intelligence Council, was headed by the Honorable FM, was mandated to formulate coordinated strategies for action, strengthen the working of individual agencies, consider amendments of laws and procedures for plugging loopholes so that effective action is taken against economic offenders, as also conduct annual monitoring, evaluation of performance and budgeting of agencies under its control. So I'm sure, all the officers are there with their experience. That, we have been working in silos, each department. So this is sort of, the idea, it was acknowledged very much that, the organizations tend to work in silos and there's hardly any sharing of information. So, and I must say that my association with REIC, in fact, began in 2008 and 2009. So at that time I was looking after anti-evasion on service tax. So I used to come to the same building, in fact, where I am sitting now, to, take part in the nodal office meeting, which is, a subset of REIC. I will be telling you more about it in the slides ahead. So CBEC or CBIC now and CBDT, both are responsible for taxation, that is indirect and direct. So our association, you know, though we are part of the same department, you know, you would agree that the coordination and the sharing and all has never been, you know, totally the way it should be. So 2008 and 9, you know, I remember when I was handling service tax, so we, you know, sort of took up the issue at, I think, the board level, and we started getting the information about renting of immovable property. I think there is a specific entry in one of your returns where, you know, they show that how much rent we have got. So I think some tax benefit or the tenant takes it. So that data started coming to us in CD form. So, you know, if I look at my earliest knowledge of information sharing was that. So the CDs would come, we would open up, and then, you know, we would have the PAN numbers, and then we would try it, because at that time the service tax registration number thankfully was PAN based. So then we would try and, you know, make cases out of that. But fortunately, in 2008 and 9, a formal MOU was signed between CBDT and CBEC at that time. So, and that MOU has been renewed now in July 2020. So it talks of automatic and regular basis information sharing between the two departments, and further on request or on spontaneous basis also, which might have utility for the other organization. So that is the linkage, or at least between the two sub departments, I would like to say, under the Department of Revenue. So the CEIB was formally set up in 1985 as the nodal agency on economic intelligence, with the mandate of coordinating and strengthening the economic intelligence and enforcement activities under the Ministry of Finance. So the bureau is headed by a director general, and it's under the overall supervision of the revenue secretary. There are two ADGs, there is a joint secretary Kofi Posa, then there are five DS director level officers, three under secretaries, and some other staff as well. So if you look at the functions of CEIB, so they are, of course, the secretariat for the Economic Intelligence Council headed by the FM. They coordinate between various agencies for joint action, and they are the repository of economic intelligence. They administer...
It's a first slide only we are able to see, ma'am. Further slide, it's stuck, I think, ma'am. Sorry.
Okay. No. I understand. One second.
Yes, now we can see information exchange mechanism.
Okay. So I'll just, so I am here. Now, is this visible functions of CEIB?
Yes, ma'am. Information exchange mechanism in CEIB.
I've just put functions of CEIB. Is that visible?
That is not visible. Okay.
Will it be possible for your joint director to share?
Now it is visible, ma'am.
Functions. Okay. So I'll go ahead. So I'm sorry. I apologize. For this. But so functions. I was on the third point. So CEIB administers the Kofi Posa Act at the central government level. Now, they also ensure prompt dissemination of intelligence having security implications amongst, you know, our top agencies, IB, RAW, and NSCS. They coordinate the functioning of the REICs. They coordinate with multi-agency center. They organize meetings of the working group under the chairmanship of the RS. And, you know, they support, they submit reports timely. And they actually act as a think tank for the DOR and on all issues relating to economic offences, and they undertake analysis of economic activities at the So this, in a nutshell, sort of shows you what CEIB does. So on the left hand side, you have REICs. There are 30 REICs in the country. On the top left, if you see the central and state enforcement agencies, so you have CBIC, CBDT, DRI, that's a Directorate of Revenue Intelligence of Customs. You have DGI, which is Directorate General of GST Intelligence. You have IB, you have CBI, you have DGFT, you have Narcotics Control Bureau, you have the Enforcement Directorate, state taxes is actually now your state GST. We have RBI, we have ROC, and we have the state police, the economic offenses wing of the state police. So CEIB possesses this NEON database. It is your National Economic Intelligence Network, and wherein you know any case which is booked and sent to them by any agency, they fit you know sort of fill it up in their database. They also have a CN, the Secure Information Exchange Network. And there are a lot of feeder agencies to CEIB. On the left hand side, you know, you will see the local organizations like GST and our income tax field formations. You have RBI, SEBI, DGFT, you have the NTRO is the National Technical Research Organization, which is under the national, which reports to the PMN under the NSA. And on the right hand side, you'll see another feeder LEAs, which are your CPD investigation wing, again, DRI, SFIO. So these agencies also straight away send information to CEIB. So REIC is a forum which brings together various intelligence and enforcement agencies of the central and the state governments in order to ensure holistic investigation of economic offences. Now, if I can just digress a bit and, you know, talk about, on one hand, we can talk about, you know, say CBIC and CBDT, both at the level of central government. But if we sort of move away from it and look at, you know, central government and state government, one can only imagine that, you know, different states, you have, you know, different setups. So how each goes about doing it, I think we don't have to go very far to know the exact, I mean, what I'm trying to say is, you know, I would like to dip into my experience in the GST Council Secretariat and in the GST Policy Wing. Now, you know, we talk about policy making processes. So you usually in the government, they say that, you know, it is incrementalism, that you just incrementally change whatever policy you have already, you know. But I think GST Council Secretariat and the way we went ahead in sort of introducing it, it was an example of a transformative public policy process. So never ever has policy making been so inclusive to have the central government and the state government sitting together across the table and framing law and rules and regulations. So, you know, now, I mean, the aim of GST is uniformity, and though we have the state act and the central GST acts, but everything is uniform. So the same thing we sort of, you know, if you look at the taxation point of view. So on one hand, you have the direct and indirect taxes. And earlier, if you look at only indirect taxes, we have, you know, we looked after central excise and service tax, and we had the state taxes department, which looked after, you know, sale of liquor and then property tax and the other state excise taxes. So it is, and the reason why GST was brought about was because, you know, everybody was working in silos and it was very difficult for the taxpayer to have common input tax credit. So similarly, REIC, I feel, is, you know, sort of takes it further and involves a lot many organizations. But of course, the idea is taxation. So like we heard about FIU, their mandate does not include investigation of tax offenses. But REIC is primarily for that. So it was constituted, and you have, like I mentioned, various enforcement investigation agencies. The REICs report directly to the CEIB. And you have designated officers of each department. So when we mentioned that these are the participants, so there is an REIC manual, 2019, they published it. So it's a very, very handy book. So whoever tomorrow, you know, if any one of you happens to be a part of REIC or is an NOG group member, you must go through that REIC manual. It's a very, very detailed manual, and there it contains details of almost everything what, you know, the REIC does. So there is a list of all the title used is designated members. So each agency's designated member has been specified that who is supposed to attend the REIC meetings. I hope this slide is visible now. The mandate of the REICs.
No, ma'am. we are still seeing functions of CIB.
So will it be possible for you to start sharing?
Okay, let me try then.
I think you know, it's better to have that slide in front of you while I'm speaking.
Yes, ma'am. I'll just try and do it.
So I've stopped sharing.
It will take about 1 minute. Meanwhile, you can just continue. I'll share it as soon as it comes.
So I was talking about the mandate of the RDICs. So the mandate is very, very specific. It says to cover all areas of economic interest to the government and not confine themselves to the field of only tax collection. So imagine that, you know, tomorrow we come across an organization which you know, sort of touched in income tax evasion. So sort of, you know, I'm the strong opinion.
The file which I have got is the Word file, actually. The file which has come to me is a Word file, ma'am. Friends, please hold on. There seems to be a little network issue. We'll just continue. Friends, ma'am is just joining back very soon in a few seconds, so please hold on.
Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. Now your voice is much more clear, and now I'm sharing the.
Okay. So, have you received the PPT?
Yes, ma'am. I have received the PPT. I'm sharing it.
Yeah, please do. And we are on the mandate of REIC.
REIC. ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ ಐ ಎನ್ ಸಿ ಐದು ಏನೋ ಇದೆ ಅಂತಂದ್ರು ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಆನ್ ಮಾಡಿಟ್ಟೀನಿ.
Anything can go wrong on a particular day when you do it. It does, and the light issue has
been visible
to everyone. The stamp value is this much.
Okay. Is the PPT visible to everyone?
Very high value. This is not stamp duty. Okay. This is stamp value. Yeah, you take
This is stamp value. This is the guidance value.
Okay. Is the PPT visible to everyone?
Higher value than the stamp value.
Okay. This is not the stamp duty.
It is not the stamp duty. Okay. It is the stamp value.
So stamp duty will be 1% of this.
Stamp duty will be. No, they would have paid 1% of this.
Your property is registered.
Yes, sir. Now it is showing, sir. Om Prakash here, sir. Now PPT is showing, sir.
Okay, PPT is showing. Good, good. So I'll just mute all the attendees so that we can hear. Madam, I'll just make Madam presenter again.
So can I start?
Yes, ma'am. You can start, ma'am. I'm just. I hope that PPT is visible to everyone. Is the PPT visible? Can you just confirm, anyone?
Yes, sir. It is visible.
Yes.
Actually, due to network, na sir, the next slide comes. It's coming very late, sir.
Okay.
So now, after proceeding, sir, you have to wait.
Okay.
But earlier, madam, when you were speaking, it was just stuck on one slide. Now it is moving, sir.
Okay, good.
So I'll now just wait for some time and get a confirmation that the next slides come, then I'll start, because there are a lot of details in the slide. So we now are at talking about the mandate of the REICs. So Like I was saying that, you know, in fact, even now when we receive cases and say, you know, cases come from the income tax department where that, you know, we went on a search operation and we found unaccounted cash, we found, you know, accommodating entries. I feel that, and say that, you know, that it is a business house or, you know, probably a trader. So I, you know, feel that a person or a corporate or an entity, if they are indulging in evasion of income tax, I think it is safe to assume that they are also indulging in indirect tax evasion and vice versa. So, and then if it is a corporate, if it's listed, then you have SEBI, you have Ministry of Corporate Affairs. So action, you know, sort of is due from all these organizations together for any entity if it is found to be indulging in fraud or tax evasion. So that is what I think the first mandate of REIC wants to specify, that please do not confine yourselves to only tax evasion. Because a company, if it is flouting one law, would be flouting other laws as well. You know, from the customs side, I can tell you that national security is again one more issue which comes up, that, you know, like we have seen recently the drone issue in Jammu and Kashmir. So that is why the mandate specifies that, you know, please do not limit yourself to only tax collection. Second one is to ensure operational coordination between different regions, different agencies of the region. Then make estimates of evasion of taxes and duties in their respective regions. Develop a computer-based network to serve as a data bank for real-time dissemination of intelligence to regional enforcement agencies. Gather general economic intelligence on trade and industry in the region and examine trends on intelligence and changing dynamics of economic offenses, including new modus operandi for such offenses, and suggest measures for dealing effectively against the economic offenders. Next slide, please. Right start.
This is the right slide, ma'am.
I don't know why I can't see
the mandate of the REIC.
Mr. Sir, Om Prakash here, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, I think your network is problem is there, sir. That's why whenever you are sharing that PPT, it is not coming, sir.
Okay, right now what you can see?
Sir, just stop sharing and reshare once.
Now we
it
can
is hanging, sir.
Now we can see the mandate of REIC, sir.
Yeah, that is what is being shared, the mandate of the REIC.
Maybe Om Prakash, his network is slow.
that's the reason. Ma'am, are you able to see the screen, mandate of the REIC?
Of course, the mandate of the REIC is visible now.
Okay. Ma'am, are you also able to see this mandate of the REIC?
Should I continue, please? Can anybody confirm?
Yes, ma'am, you can, please.
Okay. So this is the next slide after the mandate, which says REIC would be a place to share information on suspicious transactions, unusual financial transactions, search and seizure cases, other economic offenses related to different agencies like banking, SEBI, police, and state excises. State excise, sorry. Trends and patterns of economic crimes. Yes, this is the slide. So, you know, if you look at this list, so basically anything related with, you know, tax and, you know, sort of going beyond those financial transactions to see if, you know, something major is involved, money laundering or national security. So all that mandate is within the REA. If you just see the bottom two lines, it says, you know, it has been specified that cases above a threshold limit. I have a slide, you know, ahead, which details this threshold limit. So it has been specified that above a certain threshold limit, agency-wise, that limit has been specified. So you have to perforce share those cases. And if you, you know, if it's required, you can organize joint operations as well. The next slide, please. I think it's taking a bit of time.
But here for us, it is visible, ma'am.
Achha, for you, it is. All right. So the REICs would meet bi-monthly. In fact, you know, now CEIB has specified the dates of the meetings of each REIC so that, you know, there is uniformity across the country. So the REICs, like I said, would be attended by designated officers. Regular minutes of the meeting maintained by the REICs detailing action taken on the information exchanged between various agencies. The net result of information exchange would be sent to the convener and made part of the minutes. So each member agency is supposed to regularly inform the REIC about cases. So the office of the convener, so the convener of REIC Delhi is Principal Chief Commissioner of Customs Delhi Zone. So she's, you know, I am heading the Chief Commissioner's unit under her. So I'm the secretary to the REIC. So the office of the convener would act as the permanent secretariat to the REIC. And let me tell you that, you know, all across the REICs, this secretariat and the convener is either from the customs or from the income tax. So like in Mumbai, it is, you know, it is with the income tax department. So the secretariat is also of income tax. So in Delhi, you know, customs is looking after it. So the convener of REIC is authorized to invite representatives from other intelligence agencies whenever matters relating to areas of their interest are taken up for discussion. And like I said, coordination is by CEIB, and there is a quarterly trend assessment report also being submitted. Next slide, please. So the next slide shows you the geographical location of the REICs. I hope it is visible.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so as you can see, it is very, very fairly distributed all over the country. Next slide, please. So this details the composition of REIC Delhi. Now, if you see the first five serial numbers, there are five representatives from the income tax. You have CIT Admin and TPS, you have Principal DIT Investigation 1, Investigation 2, you have CIT TDS 2, and you have DIT INCI Admin. Now, you know, I must tell you that I have taken over you know, as Secretary NOG, I'll talk about more about what the nodal officers do from January. And what we saw was, you know, I will, of course, bring you those details in the slides ahead, that there was, you know, a lot of, in fact, you know, income tax had the maximum number of cases allocated to them. And we were not getting an update on those cases for a very, very long time from the income tax department. So, you know, my convener was also, you know, very conscious of this fact. You know, we don't get updates. And the thing is, you don't get updates you know, it not only affects the, you know, the case, what is made out of the case, the detection and recovery, which, you know, is the primary objective of sharing cases amongst different organizations, is also defeated. So I'm very conscious of the fact that I'm addressing income tax officers, so I do not want to sound very critical. But, you know, we understood that since there were so many organizations being represented in the REIC, perhaps that was one of the reasons why we were not getting regular updates. So in the month of February, perhaps my convener wrote to the chairman, and I think at that time he was member investigation also. So a DO letter was sent, and you know, we sort of requested that can a nodal officer be appointed who sort of represents the income tax department in REIC, gets updates from, of course, we understand each respective you know, organization within the department. So, you know, happily, you know, he responded in the positive, and your additional director, DIT, DGIT. So she, I mean, this Ms. Sudha Gupta is her name. So she has been nominated to represent the income tax department from the on behalf of the income tax department now. So this list will, of course, now go under, you know, will get updated. So now we have only one representative coming to REIC from your department. And I can understand, you know, the task is cut out for her because she needs to get inputs from everybody and then inform. So, in fact, thankfully, September 19, 2019 was the last time we got an update from the income tax department. But, you know, after the appointment of a nodal officer, we, you know, I held the last Friday was my NOG meeting. So we got an update. So after September 2019, at least June 2021, we've got an update. So I think this idea has sort of worked, that it's, you know, it is better to have a nodal officer from your department to represent. So if you just see the list, I think, you know, you can quickly glance through it. I won't read each and every name. We have FIU India director with us. Now, if you just look at entry number 26, it says RBI. Now, what is interesting is that the cases actually which get sponsored in the REIC, they actually come from the banks. So you have PNB, you have, you know, Bank of Baroda, Central Bank of India. All these banks send their FMRs to us through CIB. But the thing is that there is an MOU which has been signed by the bank and RBI, that RBI represents, you know, the banks in the REIC. So this can be a positive and a negative also, that, you know, if you want to ask a specific question to any bank, that's not possible, or if you want to get some more details, but that is the mandate, the MOU, which is the signed by RBI and the bank. Like I said, I think somebody's mic is unmuted. I hope I'm clearly audible. Yeah, thanks. So, like I said, the convener can invite other major, any other member agency, and add special invitees. So, next slide, please. So, the next slide just details the responsibilities of the convener. So the convener is actually has a very special and critical role to play. He's the captain of his team and is expected to guide, persuade, and enforce appropriate adherence to the guidelines to ensure that team spirit prevails. So like I've mentioned before, the office of the convener is the secretariat. And if for some reason, if the convener is not able to chair the meeting, so another senior officer of another organization would be requested. I hope the slide is visible.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so if you can just see the last paragraph, like I mentioned that, you know, CEIB recently specified the dates that, you know, on what day the REIC meeting should happen, and they've done it for all. So for Delhi, these are the dates which have been specified. So REICs meet bi-monthly, and in between it is expected that a nodal officers group meeting also takes place. So the REIC, like I said, has designated members, and they're all of the level of DSW, or, you know, the commissioner level officers. And The nodal officers is one level below. So the details are would be there in the slides ahead. Next slide, please. So the responsibilities of the designated members in REICs has also been specified that they are senior officers, and you know, so they sort of decide whether a case which has been sponsored should be taken up by them or not. So they have to own up to the action taken on information exchange and suggest remedial measures. It is only under unavoidable circumstances should a designated member delegate, you know, his junior to attend the REIC meeting. And, you know, guidelines have been specified that continuous non-attendance would consecutively over 4 to 5 meetings would be brought to the notice of CIB. Excuse me. So, you know, every meeting, the minutes have the list of participatory members. And I will, you know, show you the forms which are there. So, like I said, the REIC manual is a very, very detailed manual, and it beautifully depicts each and every form. So if you just see, just, you know, REIC form 1 and 2, they are the major forms which, you know, we need to fill up after each meeting. Next slide, please. So the agenda for the REIC meeting, you know, again, it is very, very detailed that, you know, A, it has to be circulated well before the meeting so that everybody gets a chance to go through it. And all the new cases which are received from CEIB during the, you know, sort of the time between the earlier REIC and the next, they are all placed together, you know, they are sort of made into a spreadsheet with all the details available and circulated well in advance to with the member agencies so that they go through each and every case and, you know, inform the secretariat either in writing before or after the meeting or during the meeting that we wish to take up a specific case. So, like I said, the agenda and specific issues have to be circulated at least 10 days in advance for members to be adequately prepared. It would include cases sponsored by member agencies so that decision on acceptance can be taken by other members and minuted. Pending cases update has to be submitted. Issues raised by members or reports of study groups, they all have to be placed before the members in the meeting. Now there is a standard agenda. So in fact, each time our minutes are you know, framed in this sequence that we review the last nodal officers group meeting. The REIC form 2 is filled up by each member agency, which details the actions taken by them on a specific case. Then any new case which is sponsored by the LEAs. Now, serial number 4, we have form 1. So it has 2 subparts. It's form 1A and form 1B. So in form 1A, the information is shared basically only for information with the other member agencies. And form 1B is a form in which they specify that the information which we are sharing is meant to be, you know, is meant specifically for one another member agency and that they should take it up. So I will just show you the forms going ahead. After that, you know, once the case is sponsored or discussed, then you talk about acceptance. Now, again, acceptance is another, I would say, Achilles heel of at least REIC Delhi. Because what is happening is cases are just sent. So like I said, the banks and the FMRs, the income tax department specifies that, you know, we've raided and we found unaccounted cash and accommodating entries. You know, from customs and GST side, we find that this show cause has been issued. So if you look at the inter-agency implication, unfortunately, with the sort of, I don't want to use the word sketchy information, but the limited information that is shared, it is very, very difficult to sort of readily take up, or rather for, you know, the secretariat or the convener to say that this agency has to take up this issue. So I will again come, you know, we'll talk about this in detail about the allocation of cases. So we discuss about any modus operandi or, you know, anything else the members want to share. So the next slide, please. So I hope this it is visible, the graph. I don't know, somehow I'm not able to see on my phone. So yes, yeah. This,
sir, can you make it full screen, sir? Slide, please.
Okay, yeah, that would be better. So, you know, like I just mentioned, cases coming to REIC for circulation, you know, we sort of put it in two bubbles, that the first one has inter-agency ramifications, and while the second one is only for information. Now, the thing is, you know, each sponsoring agency needs to specify that this case that we are sending, whether it is only for information or whether it is for taking, it has to be taken up by another agency. Next slide, please. So even though I just said that, you know, there are two bubbles, but one can understand that strict compartmentalization cannot take this practice, because say, you know, I have been working in my department for so long, can only know so much about the other department. So I may think that, you know, this case may not be of interest to anybody, but somebody else might say that, yeah, this, there can be another issue, or, you know, something can happen. So there is no strict compartmentalization in practice. And in fact, when we talk about the rate of allocation going ahead, I will show you that you know, it is something really sort of alarming. So that is when, you know, sort of REIC Delhi in particular, the rate of allocations was not up to the mark. So when we took it up with CIEB, so, you know, that's when this manual and everything, we were shown that, you know, it is very clear that Form 1A or Form 1B. So we have been telling the agencies to do the needful, but unfortunately, you know, it hasn't been forthcoming. So that stand that we have taken from REIC Delhi is that we will assume that everything is for information. And of course, the cases are circulated well in advance. So in case, you know, if anybody wants to take it up, you know, they're most welcome. So now members would furnish information that all shareable cases are under the ISP. This is your information sharing protocol, which again, I will talk about it in detail in the ahead slides. And so the modus operandi has to be shared, and they have to report action in REIC Form 2. Next slide, please. So the next slide has actually the excerpts from the manual. So how discussion on acceptance of cases and action taken has to be done. Is it visible? I don't know, my screen somehow shows the previous slide.
Discussion on acceptance of cases.
Yeah, discussion. So this is the, we've taken it from the manual. I just, you know, thought that it is important because this is where REIC Delhi at least is stuck. Now the manual clearly says that as far as possible, the cases shared by members should be accepted by members in the course of the meeting. The only exception can be made if acceptance in writing is received by the convener in the subsequent REIC meeting. In case of any clarification, the designated officer who has sponsored the case is to be contacted within this period. If no intimation is received regarding acceptance by convener in the next REIC meeting, it is to be presumed that the agencies identified have not found the case action worthy, and the convener will thereafter close the case for those agencies. Now, you know, closure of cases is something I'll, you know, sort of come to it in just a bit. So, you know, the case has come, and now, like I said, it has not been specified with it, whether it's a Form 1A form and or a Form 1B form, Form 1B case. But in case a suggestion is made, but we need confirmation from the receiving member agency whether they accept it or not. So the second bullet point mentions that cases shared earlier need to be reviewed in each REIC meeting so that the outcome of the case is monitored. So I will just come to you with the figures on that. And agencies are expected to have well-defined deadlines by which action needs to be initiated and completed. And so the attempt, of course, would be to complete all pending actions well before the matter is likely to be time barred. Now, cases can be closed and reporting be dispensed with only when the matter has been assessed or adjudicated. That is, your income tax assessment has taken place or adjudication by, you know, in GST or customs cases, and additional revenue has been detected or realized. And for cases pertaining to other REICs, the sending REIC would close the cases only when the receiving REIC has accepted this in the written communication. Thereafter, the receiving REIC would show in pendency and take these cases to conclusion. Next slide, please. So these are the famous forms that I've been mentioning for so long. So this is form 1A. You know, so it just says cases sponsored by the member agencies for information. So here you say you have details like date of detection, search or seizure, the name of the company, the director's address, registration numbers which are available, the duty amount involved, the information in brief. So that is your modus operandi or what offense, and the contact information of the designated member. So in case the agency wants to know more details. Now, form 1B, if you look at serial number 9. So this demands that the sponsoring member agency has to tell us to other departments or agencies who are to consider the information for further action. So this is the stark difference between the two forms. Next slide, please. And the next slide is showing you form 2, which is what the member agency sent to us, which detail the information in the sense of what, if you just see column number 5, they show us the details of the cases or information exchange, the action taken or the current status, results, additional revenue detected, additional revenue realized, and final status or remarks. So this is what is expected from the agencies which have taken up the cases to send regular updates in this format. Next slide, please. So we now turn to assessment of offense trends or study groups. Is it visible? I don't know, maybe my screen, you know,
yes, there is some.
So any new modus operandi, you know, if you for in regard of money laundering, evasion of taxes, cheating, forgery, or any such frauds can, you know, be sent to REIC to, you know, sort of prevent and predict any future frauds. And REICs are also expected to aid and assist the Ministry of Finance in gathering intelligence and offense cases, analyzing the modus operandi adopted and resultant loopholes, or any shortcomings detected in the system, procedures, and existing legal framework, and suggesting suitable remedial action. Now, I mentioned this earlier about joint action or coordination among members. So joint action is expected, or it could be a follow-through also between member agencies. So convener, in fact, can, you know, sort of allow, and it can happen. So next slide, please. So this is a slide on, you know, a study group was formed under the aegis of REIC Delhi on fake or bogus GST invoices and how to contain the menace. So it had members from CGST, that is your central GST, DGGI, our GST intelligence agency, income tax, Delhi police, and ROC. Now, just highlight. So these are just the main points which were highlighted by the study group. So it mentioned that, you know, what is the modus operandi? So basically they use fake PAN or Aadhaar numbers, or they use PAN numbers of, you know, innocent workers. You have your, you know, some people who are not even aware that there are companies named after them. And again, they are just paper invoices, and no goods or services are accompanying them. And it's only when this racket, I think, when it gets a bit too big, that you know, we realize that we have to do something. And it's sort of, you know, in from the GST side, I can tell you that, you know, we are now putting alerts. Now, some of these fake companies, you know, they show even import and export. You know, for export, then they take ineligible drawback. So now what we are doing is putting alerts in the system so that drawbacks are not disbursed to them, you know, if they are found to be involved in any such thing. So what was interesting, you know, so it was sort of a confidential report. So I, you know, cannot share with you all the details. But what was interesting was, you know, they mentioned the role of REIC in coordinating the investigation between various agencies. So as we are doing already, but this was one, the major recommendation of the study group, that if the REIC can act as sort of the nodal, and this requires, you know, real-time data information exchange. So this report has been submitted and it is under consideration, but it is definitely one of the options that, you know, that real-time data information exchange is routed through the REIC, and cases are sort of handled and booked and sort of, and the perpetrators are nabbed. So that is the main thing, because these are just fly by night type operators, and you know, they just disappear. So in fact, you know, apart from this real-time information sharing suggestion, they also mentioned that the IT Act, I think there's a section 271 AAD. So if any one of you wants to enlighten us about this act, it will be welcome. That I think it deals with false entry in books of account. So the group had suggested an amendment in this section as well to, I think, perhaps provide for greater punishment. Would anybody want to speak on this section? If anybody's dealt with it or have any extra information, I would also like to get enlightened. So if nobody wants to speak, then we can move on to the next slide. So now we come to the nodal officers group, which is the secretariat. So I sort of you know, chair the NOG meeting. And it is, so my computer is up actually. So I'm just trying to switch it on. Okay. So the NOG has been set up in order to avoid delays in sharing of information and timely action. So that, you know, each REIC has an NOG. So like I said, REICs tend to meet bi-monthly. So in between we have the NOG that, you know, sort of, looks after the cases. So the case, same again, the cases which come to us between the REIC and the next NOG are shared in the NOG meeting. So the level of participation in this is a deputy director or a DC level, that is your undersecretary level. And this forum is expected to provide further information or documents requisitioned from sponsoring agencies, and also review of cases pending. The NOG is expected to meet in the intervals between two REIC meetings, like I've said, and the minutes need to be reported to the convener, and we need to send them to CEID. But the minutes of each REIC meeting, yes, those are sent. Now, preparation and circulation of minutes. Next slide, please. So the minutes of REIC meeting are to be drawn as per the agenda items, which I showed you in the previous slide. So, you know, you take sort of stock taking of the cases already sponsored, and you discuss the new cases, you discuss new modus operandi, you discuss reports of any study groups or any other issue that, you know, any other member agency wants to flag. The minutes of the REIC meeting is to be sent in soft copy. We send it within 15 days. So in fact, the minutes get prepared within the next two or three working days and they're circulated. And along with the minutes, the annexure 1 and 2. Now, annexure 1 and 2 are the ones which detail, you know, the whole the list of cases which are there with, you know, REIC. Next slide, please. Now, this is very interesting that, you know, each REIC is ranked. In fact, the revenue secretary does an analysis. I mean, he's his office and the annual appraisal is done. And these are the seven criteria on which REIC Delhi is ranked. So we were, in fact, I think a couple of years ago, we were number two. And last year, we sort of slipped. And I'll show you the reasons why we slipped to 11th. So number of meetings concluded last year because of, you know, the corona pandemic, one less REIC meeting was held. I think April or May didn't take place. So we scored less on that account. Then attendance of designated members. Unfortunately, again, in REIC Delhi, we are facing this problem where the designated members, which are the, you know, commissioner ADG level, they don't seem to be able to attend these meetings. So in fact, again, January, February, we sent out DO letters to all the member agencies to, you know, sort of mention that please ensure your designated members attend. Then the recommendation of study groups and studies conducted, those are, you know, sort of also considered for ranking. And any action taken to carry cases to closure, additional revenue detected, additional revenue realized, and joint action and arrest. So we have to forward these details to, you know, the CEIB by 15th April so that we get that ranking done. Now, next slide, please. This is our annual performance report. So these are the details where, you know, on which we are ranked. And so I have mentioned these cases. So, you know, additional revenue detected and realized. Now, that is one of the main things that, you know, sort of, I think perhaps is the reason why our ranking slipped quite badly this time. Next slide, please. So this is the information sharing protocol. Can I just take, you know, just half a minute of a break? I'm trying to get on to my system because, you know, I think the PPT that I've shared has, you know, last few slides that changed in the last moment, and I happen to send you the, you know, the second last draft. So can I just be given 1 minute? I'll just WhatsApp you that draft so you can just quickly share that.
Okay, ma'am. Please send me the revised PPT. I'll share that.
I'm really sorry for all these goof ups.
It happens, ma'am. We are in the online process, still learning this process, trying to make it as convenient as possible. But given the situation, I think that gradually over a period of time, these things will be overcome.
Yes. So this information sharing protocol, so I don't know, it's just taking a bit of time. Yeah, 1 sec, it's open. So I'll just probably have this, I'm trying to open my web WhatsApp, so it's taking time. So I'll just get a way to send it to you. 1 second. Yeah, 1 minute. So I sent it to you. It's just taking some time. So I'll start, and as and when you receive it, you can quickly just sort of download it and share that. I don't know why it's just taking some time. So I'll continue. So the information sharing protocol. So our nodal officers to be appointed who will be responsible for ensuring that reporting is done regularly. All cases where offense is detected, irrespective of the nature of offense, which involves contravention of any economic statute, has to be shared within a week of such detection or adjudication. So these are, you know, the thresholds and everything that I had mentioned, that they have been specified for each organization. Now, in cases where inter-agency ramifications are noticed during investigation, that agency should be informed directly to save time, along with all the supporting facts and figures, with a copy to CEIB. And sharing may be done through the CN, which is your secure information exchange meeting, or a hard copy till these platforms are set up. So right now, I think presently it's all hard copy. And apart from the primary details, which are, you know, your PAN number, your IEC code, your GSTIN, your CIN, DIN, and any other details that you feel should be shared, modus operandi, specifying interagency ramification, so all that. So I think you've received the PPT, right?
Yes, ma'am, I've received the PPT.
Yeah. So can you just share that? So I just made changes, some last minute changes, so it's better. So luckily, all this is all right. So just let me know when I should start. So we'll come to the next one, which is stages of information sharing, where, it is, like I said, the manual is very, very detailed. It clearly specifies that, what is to be done when.
What is the page number that we have to come to?
It was just the next slide from which we were on already. I'll just tell you the slide number, 1 second.
I think this was the one, yeah.
Stages of information sharing. It's got, I'll just tell you. So it's slide number 29.
This is the one, ma'am. I've shared it.
Again, I think there is some lag in my system. So 29, So you can see those stages 1 to 4.
1 to 6 is there, ma'am. Yeah, stages 1 to 4 and serial number 6. Yeah.
So, for DRI, that is our Directorate of Revenue Intelligence, which looks into customs cases. So the seizure and detection intimation report within 15 days of booking and within 60 days in cases where sharing may affect investigation. That is our stage 1 of sharing. Then stage 2 comes at the time of show cause. So in fact, each copy of a show cause of DRI above 50 lakh rupees is perforce marked to CIB/REIC. Then orders in original are also sent, and that is your stage 3, and the stage 4, of course, will be prosecution and coffee posa, if there are any such implications. So like this, for each, member agency, the stages have been defined very, very specifically, that when is information exchange expected to be shared. So next slide, please. So these are the details of, 15 organizations. Can we go on to slide number 31? Now this specifies the threshold limits for mandatory exchange of information. Can you confirm that that is visible?
Yes, ma'am, visible, ma'am.
Yeah. So the threshold limits for mandatory exchange of information, like I said, 50 lakh rupees has been specified for DRI cases. Duty evasion of 1 crore, but seizure of assets of 50 lakhs. For, from the GST side, rupees 5 crores in a metro when it comes to suppression of production, turnover, or sales. And in case of tax evasion, it is 2 crores. For CBDT, in case of seizure of assets, it's ₹2 crores in Delhi, and concealment of income is 5 crores. Similarly, for ED, SEBI, state tax, and the economic offenses wing of state police, it's up to 3 crores. Now, threshold limit in case of other agencies which have not been specified can be decided by the REIC. So again, that would sort of, be dependent on, if, say, a unique modus operandi is noticed. So I think in those cases, the threshold limit may not be adhered to and still shared with REIC. Next slide, please. Now, these are the Delhi statistics. And, perhaps if you just take a close look through it, you will understand why, that slippage in ranking took place from number 2 to number 11. The top table shows you the percentage of unaccepted cases. So if you see, I am very much aware of the fact that if you simply compare 2019 to 2020, the number of cases introduced were 253, and in the next year it was 631. So it's safe to say that it was, more than double. And acceptance rate, unfortunately, slipped from, rose from the unallocated percentage rose from 19% to 86.5%. And of course, 21-22 is just begun. And, we've had 56 cases that we've shared till now in the REIC, and only one case has been accepted. So again, the percentage shows right now 98.2%. So this is the primary problem that at least, the REIC Secretariat is facing, that, since the sponsoring agencies are not specifying which other member agencies should take it out. And we at the Secretariat level do go through all the details which are available and suggest it in the meeting. But unfortunately, there is no concurrence from any of the members during the meeting or afterwards in writing. So that is the reason why these unallocated cases, the number keeps piling up. And you would think that, once in case, if the cases itself are not being picked up, then, the detection and recovery, everything would get hit. So the second table shows you, sort of just gives you the details of which agencies are picking up the cases. So you have ED and income tax. Income tax, hopefully now with the new nodal officer, and of course, you would have to get details from every other of your those concerned agencies. But ED, I must say, has been a very, very active member in REIC Delhi. So I don't want to, bore you with these details, but I just want to give you a glimpse of, the issues or the, the cases coming and what is being done. Next slide, please. So if you would see that, your department is at serial number one, that, you have the most cases pending with you. So there are a total of 312, and this slide we had just prepared, last week. So September 19, of course, would now become June 2021 because we've got an update. But, and this is just for the past 3 years, you see 83, 71 and 4. So the updates have come now. And unfortunately, for cases which were shared, earlier, and information was pertaining to, say, 2008-09. So the update that we've got now is that no action can be taken by under the Income Tax Act, which is safe to say that those cases have become time barred. So in fact, we had the DG of CEIB also come attend one of our REIC meetings in January to say that, in case member agencies don't respond in time, then cases would become time barred. But, not just income tax, even, the central GST commissioners have responded to us saying that, cases of 2014. Now, in case, if a case is shared in 2014 with REIC, now it is safe to assume that the offense would have taken place, say, in the earlier years. And even perhaps in 15 also, maybe the offense took place. But unfortunately for us, the limitation period is 5 years. So again, it is safe to say that all those cases have become time barred. So that has been, we've been trying to, we have all these statistics. In fact, this table that I show you right now, I'm just showing you a few entries. We sort of has a we have a bigger spreadsheet than this, which details that when was it shared, what update. So, you know, this is the issue that because updates don't come, and you know, we're not able to sort of perhaps, you know, these cases, I can assume that they perhaps won't be at the top of the priority of some of the member agencies. But from, you know, the REIC secretariat side, for us, these are, you know, very important cases, and we feel that they should reach, you know, their conclusion, and sort of the final result is shown to us. Next slide, please. So I think from a little bit of pessimism, I want to shift towards the, you know, optimistic side, and to show that there has been significant achievement and results. You know, REIC Delhi has been able to show that. So in fact, if you see this first case, you know, the Appughar case, it was sponsored by Income Tax and was taken up by the GST Commissionerate. And, you know, this was actually a recovery of 9.8 crores. I hope that slide is visible.
Slide is visible.
Yeah, okay. So the number one case, it was sponsored by the Income Tax. So, and it was said that they were unaccounted for cash transactions. So in fact, their major, you know, their amusement parks closed because they hadn't paid electricity bills and everything. But it was taken up by CGST and their liability was found, and we got recovery also. So I've just detailed, you know, top 10 cases which was sponsored. And if you see, they have been sponsored by Customs, by CBI, by Delhi Police, by DRI. And they've been taken up by ED in a big way, and trade and taxes earlier. So ED, CGST, and, you know, in fact, you know, I must share that Income Tax is actually quite active in the other RTICs. I happen to speak with, you know, some of them, like I mentioned, Mumbai. So Mumbai REIC Secretariat is also under the Income Tax. So there, perhaps, you know, maybe that the chain of information sharing is more efficient, that they show a lot of recovery from the Income Tax Department. And that is primarily one of the reasons why we've been, you know, sort of after your department to, you know, start giving us status updates, you know, and because we expect detection and recovery from your side, that as like in the other REICs. So this is just, you know, just a few details. You can, you know, go through them because I have not given too much of details. So, like, you know, ED shared this detail DRI headquarters shared this information. If you look at serial number 6, that, you know, goods were exported, were misdeclared, and ineligible GST compensation cess refunds were sought. So ED took it up and sort of had a detection of 578 lakhs. Next slide, please. So this is just a news clipping from the Indian Express where, you know, the Nirav Modi scam, the IT report. Now, I have my information on this account is only limited to what I read, you know, in the newspaper. So if somebody has more information, or, you know, I may be wrong, but what I read and what this news article showed was that, in fact, if you read the byline, it says, sources said the tax department before February 2018 also did not share its findings through the Regional Economic Intelligence Council, a mechanism for sharing of information between various law enforcement agencies. So it's good to read about REIC, but now what the article says is that there was a IT probe report. I think it's called an investigation appraisal report, which was 10,000 pages long. And it was prepared, and raids were conducted in 2017 in, I think, his offices, his residence. And it's a June 2017 report. But this was not shared. And it's only later that, you know, all this fraud, the bank fraud and everything came forth. So the article mentions that after this sort of lapse, Now, per force, you know, I think you have to share your investigation appraisal reports with FIU. And in fact, they're quoting the department saying that, you know, since there was no protocol in place, we could not, you know, sort of share the information. Now, they say that now instructions are clear that these have to be shared with FIU, which will in turn share it with other agencies. So, in fact, now in hindsight, of course, we are much wiser, and we could say that once income tax saw that, you know, there was a lot of sort of gifts, entries to members of family, and a lot of loans being given. So I think Ministry of Corporate Affairs, the ED, and of course, you know, the banks and all could have been involved. But again, it's easier to say that, you know, what all could have been done in hindsight. But this is one thing we came across. Next slide, please. So this is the last slide, in fact, of the presentation. Now, you know, like it was mentioned that I happened to do this MBA PG diploma course in public policy management. So I've just tried to draw some learning from that, you know, course that I did. Now, I think you would agree that each and every government department, so not only law enforcement, I would like to say, in policy making also, we have, you know, I think in, during the course of our own careers, we've seen that there's been major shift in focus. So if I just go back to a little bit of theory of public policy and management, that earlier on there used to be old public administration, that was the paradigm it was working in, that you know, you had one department doing everything, each department looking after a specific area. Then new public management came, that now you have to look at government policy making also as a project, so you know, as corporates look at it. And finally, now today we are in the realm of new public service, that now everything is looked upon as a service to the citizens. And so, and this new public service, the technical term which is in fact defined is whole of government approach. Now, whole of government approach means that it is not only just one department who will sit in isolation, like, you know, we would say that departments tend to work in silos. So that would go away, the silos, walls would all be broken apart, and different departments would sit together and formulate policies. That is what you mean by when you say a whole of government approach. And I think REIC is one forum which beautifully depicts this whole of government approach, that all these law enforcement agencies come together, look at cases, and, you know, sort of take it forward. And, you know, like your ADG Vivek Kumar sir mentioned in the beginning, and what, you know, Mishra ji also spoke. Now, harnessing the power of information technology cannot be overemphasized, I think, at any given point of time. Data mining, you know, you have data is what? Zeros and ones. We tend to convert it into information. Then we sort of rearrange it so that it becomes intelligence. And through that, we obtain knowledge, you know. And in our cases, it's mostly post-mortem. So all this data gets together in data warehouses, which are your repositories of data. And I must, you know, congratulate the Income Tax Department on how they have worked in this field of reportings and data mining, and how robust an IT system you have. In fact, a very small thing that, you know, that certificates coming to the taxpayers, that silver and bronze, depending on the amount of income tax paid. You know, I remember, you know, I had people coming to say, oh, wow, see, we've got a silver certificate. So these are the little things that how you sort of, you know, harness the power of information technology and, you know, in delivering service. So we must realize that we are in the, you know, we are public servants and we have to provide service. So the reporting system that we tend to build on the data captured is then used, of course, for decision making and investigations. So, you know, you have artificial intelligence now coming in a big way. Business intelligence solutions are being built, I can tell you, in the GST systems. And, you know, you have chatbots and you have different ways of sort of dealing with this, sort of harnessing the power. Risk-based audit and investigation is what now we do. We do not just, you know, randomly pick up assessees and, you know, do their audit or investigation. And in this, you know, they say that focus should be on big data, yes, but also better data, so that, you know, you are able to curate clear data sets and learn from them. And in this aspect, you know, cybersecurity is also one more thing that, you know, I'm sure the income tax department has taken care of it, that, you know, the data privacy has to be ensured. So, you know, this is the essence of, you know, what I wanted to say, that REIC wants to show that, you know, we've moved to the new public service, you know, that set up where there is whole of government approach, holistic, you know, investigation taking place in, you know, unison with different agencies, which have, you know, different protocols and different ways of, you know, functioning. And at the same time, harnessing this power, like this NEON database that I mentioned earlier. So CEIB tends to feed all the cases which come to them in that NEON database. So I think that's one of the very useful places where, you know, we can get information and perhaps dig up more cases from there. Next slide is just a thank you slide. I must thank, you know, the sponsors and all the participants for bearing with me. I'm really sorry. And I think Murphy's Law has got greater meaning in my life now than ever before, that, you know, again, there was no light and suddenly the lights have come up, but, you know, the Wi-Fi modem, everything was not working. But thankfully, my mobile phone came to the rescue. So I welcome any questions anybody has, and thanks a lot once again for giving me this opportunity to speak.
Well, we request participants to engage and put any questions that you may have, any elementary question also is welcome, because ma'am is the secretary of the REIC, and she's been handling a very, very important portfolio there, trying to bring all the government departments together, and so that information can be shared together and can be taken to some conclusion. Yes, please, anyone? You can raise your hands if you want, or you can just unmute yourself and speak. Anyone who would like to say anything or ask any question? Those questions lead to discussion and answers and to clarification.
I think one person has raised their hand, Ranglal Meena ji, yeah. I think.
Okay, Mr. Ranglal Meena ji, please ask your question. Unmute yourself. Are you able to unmute yourself?
Good afternoon, ma'am. Good afternoon, sir. May I say something?
Yes, please.
Yeah, please.
Ma'am, this is Garima Gad. I'm being freshly posted as ACIT under the Office of Principal Commissioner Income Tax Delhi. So this is like a very, maybe a naive question, but I really want to ask, like, what we can do to improve the coordination, like from our side with the Regional Economic Intelligence Unit, and like what are the options from where we can, you know, actually put in the core information which can actually act as intelligence for the unit.
So I'm very, very happy to hear from you. So, you know, so you are sort of my counterpart here in Delhi under, you know, in the Chief Commissioner's unit. So, like I said, you know, other REICs, you know, you would have been in the secretariat, or perhaps your additional commissioner or joint commissioner would have been, you know, secretary to the REIC. So, like you saw that, you know, the designated members have been specified. Those are your four CITs, I think your DGIT investigation. I don't know the, you know, the details, but you saw in the PPT that those four designated members are there. And now we've gotten one additional director from the DGIT office to be the nodal. Now, perhaps you can, Sudha Gupta is her name. So perhaps, you know, you can speak with her and, you know, I feel she has her job cut out because she has to get inputs from, you know, all your four other sister wings, I would say. So, you know, I don't think I'm the right person to tell you how to go about it, but you must speak with her and perhaps the earlier designated members over there that how best to, you know, sort of ensure that timely updation is sent to us about your, you know, about the cases which are pending. So, you know, I don't know whether it was right on my part to share this with you that the update that we now got, you know, it was clearly mentioned that those cases are time barred. So, you know, if you can discuss it perhaps with your chief commissioner, because it is a very, you know, serious matter. I don't know what we are going to do about it because this is only now that not only you, but even our CGST commissionerate has told us that, sorry, you know, these cases, oh, it's investigation is going on. Or something shared in 2014, you cannot tell us investigations are still going on. Because I don't think a person who did, you know, say clandestine removal of goods would still indulge in that in 2021. So, you know, I really appreciate you asking this question. But, you know, I unfortunately cannot give you an answer for that. But you please speak with Ms. Sudha Gupta and, you know, sort of the other designated members. And, you know, we really, really want active participation from the Income Tax Department because we really feel that, you know, you can track those cases and show us detection and recovery.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for your answer. Ma'am, another question which is there is like, is there any entry level jobs in the RDIC for the ACID level officers?
See, like I said, see, I am the additional commissioner in the Chief Commissioner's Unit of Delhi Zone. So this is just one another added role that I do. So, you know, there is no such posting for REIC. As such, you can get posted in CEIB, which is, you know, under the Department of Revenue, where you have these different units like FIU, you had the, you know, the JS officers here. So REIC is actually, we are sitting in the field. And like we are the headquarters in Delhi Customs Zone, if you see the commissionerate says field. So I'm sitting in the headquarters of that. So I just perform this role, which is an additional role. So I don't get specifically posted in REICs. But CEIB, if you want to be in the ministry, you could get, you know, that's your deputation. But not here. This is just an additional. So in fact, you know, we were going to look into how that REIC Delhi's charge can be handed over to income tax, because I was told that there is something written in the manual where, you know, it has to be shared between the two departments, say, I think every few years. So, you know, we were going to look into it, but now that I have heard from you, we can see, and perhaps this whole mandate can be shifted to you for a few years. I mean, there's no harm in it, I think.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your answer.
Mr. Ashish Kumar,
it was a really insightful session. Like for an entry level officer like me, it's very good to have, you know, a wider perspective of what other things that we can do in coordination with other sister agencies, so as to have better perspective of things. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you.
Mr. Ashish Kumar, please.
Kumar from DD, DDIT Investigation Dhanbad in Jharkhand. My question is, as a fact, I know that sometime back, about 2 years back, a search has been taken place from the Department of GST about some bogus billing. So I just want a clarification about how much time the GST department normally take to report us and in what form, because whenever we get information, generally we get in the form of alerts number such and such on such and date. So is it in the form of reports or it is it in the form of alerts only? So that we can get, you know, more information about that search. Generally, we share from Income Tax Department, we share that is called appraisal reports. But from there, we generally get alerts only, which is very sketchy. So that is the migration. Hello.
Sorry. I think I was muted. Sorry. So if you could, you know, refer to one of the slides that I showed where the REIC manual prescribes the stages, you know, it's under the information sharing protocol that
yes.
For each agency, the stages have been specified. Now, I can tell you from my own little experience that I have of these cases. Now, you know, this is what the manual says. The manual clearly says, say for, you know, DGGI, if, you know, they've booked a case. So the offense report, and it's called an AE2. So that has to be shared immediately. And then the show cause, and then the order in original, and, you know, the fourth stage is prosecution, if at all you think about it. But in reality now, you know, today, in fact, is the fourth anniversary of GST's introduction. You know, I think it is still a system which is taking time to stabilize, you know, and so what you are mentioning is that, you know, this fake invoices, bogus invoices issue is, you know, is one of perhaps one of the biggest menace that, you know, the authorities have to deal with. So how they've gone about, unfortunately, I don't have the field experience that, you know, how they go about it. But the moment, you know, anything is sort of detected. And again, it is up to the prerogative, I think, of the investigating agencies, whether they think that it should be shared with, you know, say, Income Tax Department or the REIC. So, and, you know, if you just saw in that slide that even like for DRI, they have specifically mentioned that, you know, OK, within 15 days, you share it. But if you feel that it would, you know, affect investigation, share it within 60 days. Okay. So, you know, I think the investigating authorities have to be very, you know, conscious of the fact that, you know, they don't compromise the investigation by, you know, sharing it with others, you know, unnecessarily. So in your case, you know, I think I can tell you the customs and GST systems talk to each other very frequently. Now, whether, you know, income tax is also roped in these cases, like you mentioned, alert. So that is, I think, the quickest way of informing you that, you know, there is the suspicion over this entity. But, you know, REIC, the stages have been specifically mentioned.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Ranglal Meena.
Yes, please, Meena ji. He's not audible right now.
Well, maybe he's not audible, ma'am. But I have learned a lot from your today's lecture because there was a lot to be learned about what REC is doing. And it is really surprising that our department is lagging far behind in sending the reports. And finally, when the reports are being sent, it is being said that the case has been time barred. So this means that whatever information was shared, no action was taken on that, and therefore this feedback mechanism, as Mishra Saab was also talking about, this feedback mechanism is very, very important and needs to be, I feel that needs to be strengthened. And as you said, that in future there is probably a proposal of all the data to be shared in a artificial intelligence manner, so that on the basis of protocols and the manner in which softwares are written, probably the data can be shared automatically between the departments. But REIC, as we can see, that it's been doing a great job, and ED is also making a lot of use of this data sharing mechanism that has been created. It's a beautiful mechanism. It brings the departments together also. So that is another beautiful thing about it. And but the very fact that, as you showed it in the graphs, that our department, in terms of raising cases also, or perhaps in terms of filing reports, final reports, there is a lot of lag, but still I feel that this REIC is a very good mechanism, and with now that you are handling it and you are fully alive to the matter, I'm very sure, and our department has also appointed another efficient officer to do the work. So in that case, since this nodal officer has been appointed now, so there will be better coordination within the department to bring out these cases or to send the reports. So far I think that probably the people who are handling it earlier, those CIT, TDS and those ranks, perhaps they were not getting the information from the entire department and bringing it together and bringing it to the REIC. So perhaps their attendance at REIC was just a little formal attendance rather than actual proactive attendance or work. So it's good. I'm happy that things are moving, and our department should also become better. And I'll send a video of your lecture to Sudha Gupta so that Madam is also alive to whatever you have said.
I was very, very happy to receive updates from her, and I could see the hard work that, you know, she must have put in to get the inputs from, you know, the other organizations. So I think, you know, I was very, very conscious of the fact that I am addressing income tax officials, and, you know, it's very easy to point fingers, arey aap ye galat kar rahe ho, ye galat kar rahe ho. So my, you know, my motive was not to say that, you know, you are not doing a good job. We totally understand. And these cases, perhaps, you know, one can understand that, you know, since they are being shared in a circuitous route through the CIB to us, that they perhaps are not too, you know, on the top of the priority list. So I think the ones which are really, really big are shared immediately. There is real-time information sharing. There is no doubt about it. So, you know, these, I am of the opinion that these cases are perhaps not on top of the priority list. So, you know, that is why they take time. But and we understand, you know, each department is overburdened with already so much that, you know, these cases probably come down in the priority. But we, I think we are on the right track, and, you know, we are very, very hopeful that, you know, REIC Delhi reaches the top again, the rankings.
So thank you, ma'am, for having been with us and guided us and given this lecture for us. It's enlightening lecture, and we have understood many new things today, and I'm sure that our participants have learned a lot, many new things themselves also. Our investigations will also seem to be getting more alive to the situation that we need to share information. So with those words, thanking you once again on the behalf of all the participants present here, as well as from on behalf of the Income Tax Department and the DTRTI Lucknow. So we thank you very much, and in spite of all your connectivity issues that you are facing today due to power outage, we were able to do a successful lecture with you, and you were very kind enough to have tried to ensure that everything is smooth and perfectly all right. We look forward to many things happening in REIC, and I hope to be in continuous touch with you. And again, once again, at any time in the future, when things also improve, we can perhaps once again get together and speak about it.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, ma'am. And to the participants, your next lecture of this course, of this webinar, is at 3 p.m. And that is by Sri K.M. Mahesh, who is another leader of sorts in the department. And you might be aware of the gas scheme, where the government has given gas connections to done a lot of direct benefit transfers to people who needed gas connections. So the problem of gas connections has been totally resolved due to efforts made by none other than Mr. K.M. Mahesh. And we'll be meeting Mr. K.M. Mahesh, and he will be talking about how the data which is coming into the INCI wing, how that is being analyzed, and how it is coming to the assessing officer's table and to the investigation wing, and how it is being utilized, and how we are able to get tax out of it or not able to get tax out of it, to what extent, and what are the problems and pitfalls. We'll get together at 3 p.m. to understand all that. So please take your lunch and get back to us by 2:45 p.m. Please join back before 2:45 p.m. so that we can continue our journey of learning about the intelligence agencies and intelligence information. And as you know, that tomorrow morning and evening, we'll be having two sessions by the FIU unit guys who are who are working under Mr. Pankaj Kumar Mishra sir, who was the keynote speaker of today. So we are into very exciting times, and I'm sure that we'll make the best use of it. And but I feel that due to the videos, we were trying with the videos, but I think that if we keep the videos off, probably we'll get a better connectivity. So we can try it in the next session. We'll try to keep the videos off, and we'll see if we can get a better connection that way. Then we'll continue with that. Otherwise, even then, if the connection is the same, then we can continue with our all videos. So please come back to us at 2:45 p.m. Have your lunch. You have 1 hour of time with you. Have your lunch and relax a bit, and then come back with us by 2:45 p.m. For the next session starting at 3 p.m. Thank you so much.